The UK should learn from the Global Financial Centre of Singapore after leaving the EU. The idea that post-Brexit Britain could become a new Singapore has been a dream of many Brexiteers. The Republic, which is just off the coast of Malaysia and gained independence in 1965, has grown into a thriving hub of luxury hotels and trading ports. But what is there to learn from Singapore's economic model? We can speak now to Dr. John Hemmings, Director of the Asia Studies Centre at the Henry Jackson Society. Thank you very much indeed for your time. Let's start with what some of the Brexiteers have kind of wanted. They want to copy the high-tech economy, low levels of taxation and regulation. Mr. Hunt indeed said that they can learn from it in terms of its educational attainment as well. How applicable is the Singapore model to Brexit, to Britain outside the European Union, do you think?
Well, I think we've already seen there's been some pushback on that from Brussels. There was a great leader in the Telegraph today from their Brussels correspondent talking exactly about the fact that this kind of language will go down very poorly with the EU, which we'll see the UK is trying to kind of operationalize its, that kind of model at EU's expense, right off the European continent. So that if we go down that way, there will be serious pushback from Brussels, and it will immediately impact the Brexit negotiations. However, on the side where I can see the benefit, there is a wider argument to be made that Britain and Singapore do have a special relationship to develop. By 2050, I believe global growth will be about 52% of GDP in the region. And we know that maritime trade will take up a bulk of that, about 50%, according to Lloyd's Register, by 2030. So I think there's also this maritime trading hub model that Singapore has that Britain would also like to emulate.
But in terms of Britain actually emulating that and the economic rise that Singapore had from the 60s onwards, you know, their economy was based on a lot of exporting at a time where the countries around them were fairly insular as well. It's not applicable to the UK in 2019, 2020, is it? They're not going to have the same sort of economic rise as the Asian Tigers did.
No. I mean, I think there's the Brexit side of this debate is certainly a domestic one. It's not very well placed for our friends in Brussels. And to be honest, I think it falls flat in Singapore. But having said that, while the things that Singapore did cannot be directly emulated, there's some things that Singapore is doing now and the way it's positioning itself as a trading hub, particularly, as I say, as we go into an increasingly maritime age, and also where economics and regional blocs begin to merge into a kind of political security nexus. The HMS Albion, the British warship that did a transit through the South China Sea this summer, showed, you know, the kind of hard power Britain trying to be a presence in Southeast Asia. I think the visit out to Singapore and Malaysia is very much in that vein. And you can see in the strategic partnership that I think they're due to announce later today or tomorrow, which is supposed to develop the relationship on a bilateral level much more intensely. So I think Hunt's, you know, descriptions are not well done and they're not well received. But the overall gist of the mission there, I think, is an important one.
Do you think that mission sounds like what you're outlining is a sort of pivot to Asia? And we've seen it from Jeremy Hunt and Gavin Williamson. And I presume that was Barack Obama's policy when he was US president. Is it coming a bit late from the British government to realise that maybe the shift to the East is that's where the action's happening?
I have to confess, as an Asia expert, I've been following that and have written indeed on global Britain in the Indo-Pacific. It makes sense for economic reasons. As I outlined before, you know, global GDP is going to Asia and it's going by sea. I think there's strong arguments to be in the region as that occurs. We're going to see an uptick in cities along the Indian Ocean basin. The global middle class will double by 2050, and they'll all be wanting British products and British goods. And so for Britain to play a role in that, it'd be excellent to position itself well with Singapore, countries like India, and of course ASEAN itself. And we can see that in the Trans-Pacific Partnership moves that Theresa May has outlined as well. Whether those will be well received, we'll see.
Just finally, on the military side, there is an argument that as China continues to militarize, and with the US being, in some people's eyes, an unreliable partner, that there is an opportunity for Britain there to strengthen alliances militarily with the likes of Singapore. Is that viable, or does Britain quite simply not have the money?
I agree. Absolutely. Political will and resources will be critical. Britain already has very deep military relationships with countries in the region. We belong to the Five Powers Defense Arrangements, of which Singapore is a member. We have a good relationship with Brunei as well. We're not the United States, and I think countries in the region are attracted to that. And there is definitely a debate about the rules-based order, of which China is a challenger, well, a limited challenger anyway. And that's very much something that I think the United Kingdom should be defending.
John Hemmings, thank you very much indeed for taking the time to speak to us this evening. Appreciate it.
Thank you.
Now, the average 10-year-old child has eaten more